Well, good morning, everybody. Sorry to give you a heart attack. Just picking up some plants from the lab. So I'm sure you've had a lot of things happening between when we last had a chat and today. So I thought I'd just give you a quick reminder. So you remember who this guy is? Edward. Oh, very good. Retention. Very good. So, and we crossed sense and antisense plants, and the deal was that if you have double-stranded RNA in a cell, you trigger this mechanism that we never knew anything about until about 10, 15 years ago, and that it recognizes the double-stranded RNA, and then it's able to munch these guys up. And you hopefully remember that there were two key enzymes. One was called DISO, which chops up this double-stranded RNA into little pieces, and Argonaut, which gets loaded into Argonaut. And I showed you that cartoon. I don't know whether I've put it in again. So, okay, I'll whisk through this just to remind you. So in this comes the double-stranded RNA, in come the dices. They chop that up into little pieces. Then they swap one strand. It's 21 bases. They swap one strand into the Argonaut. And so there we are. That's the dices done its bit, and that's the Argonaut's done its bit. Okay, now we bring in the double-stranded RNA. The single-stranded RNA, and it now recognizes the sequence and kills it off, yeah? So you hopefully remember this from 2 days ago. So I thought we'd continue. And first of all, I thought I'd show you just how beautiful these molecules really are. I mean, I showed you them as purple blobs and stuff. But nature has done a superb job, I think, in... So well done, whoever designed it. And so here you go. This is the dicer, and this is it. And this is the structure that crystallography sorts of people show. So this is what's called an alpha helix, and there's somewhere here beta sheets. But basically, this is just drawing what this does. So that's the protein there, and that's the double-stranded RNA. And so what it does is you see here's a little pocket. That's that pocket there. So it catches an end, and it sees that, and it puts that in that pocket, and it measures the length. I'm afraid this is an old slide, so that should actually say 21, but, you know, these crystallographers, they're pretty hopeless. So they go along there, and then there's an ion here and an ion here, and then they just bring it up, and then snick, snick, it cuts it. And so that's how it measures that perfect 21. This is this blobby protein thing here. Beautiful pair of scissors that perfectly cuts it. And then it loads it into Argonaut, and this is perhaps a bit messier, but this is the structure again. And the blue one is the single strand that's been loaded from one of these, and this red one here is the RNA that's coming in that's going to be cut. So we now know, you know, rather than just showing you just these little spheres or circles and stuff, this is perhaps shows you more of the actual sort of structure of the proteins that's doing it. Okay. So you may, again, remember from back in, we talked about nanoparticles and Monsanto and all that sort of stuff. And we talked about delivery and how you could deliver it. And I was talking about putting in genetic constructs, and we said that actually there was a new technology on the block. I think I said that. And it comes from Monsanto. So I threw in a couple of slides just to show you that. So I'm sure you've heard about... nanoparticles for the last 2 days.
A bit.
So I'm not really up on nanoparticles, but this is the nanoparticle they use. It's a hairy nanoparticle. I don't know, you heard about hairy nanoparticles? Okay. So here's this particle, and these are these little sort of hairy bits, and what that does is it traps those 21 nucleotide RNA. So you make this, I mean, they did this fancy sort of chemistry to find out just the right polymer. But once they've got this figured out, this sort of hairy particle, and then you just dunk it in your single-stranded 21 nucleotide RNA, and it sticks to these things. And then you can inject it into your bloodstream, and it'll go to the liver and so on. And in actual fact, so this was developed for medical research, but Monsanto have got in the deal, and so these are what particles look like when you look down a microscope. And then instead of making this genetic transformation, you can just spray it on your crop instead. Just do this transient expression. You just make it up and spray it. So this is sort of got people in a bit of a tiz. Some people think it's great. Some people think it's maybe not so great and all thinking about the risks and so on. But it certainly seems to work. So here, for example, they've sprayed onto these things, making these plants herbicide resistant. Whereas these guys that haven't been sprayed with it, you spray with a herbicide and they're dead dogs, or dead plants, in fact. So here's the sprayed and protected with these small RNAs. Here's unsprayed but with a protected but sprayed with a herbicide. Similarly, here's a virus protection, and I think somewhere here is a, perhaps it's the next one, is protection against insects. So here's a technology that you can, instead of doing a genetic transformation, you just spray the stuff on and you can protect against these different things. So anyway, I throw that in because we had that discussion. What I'd like to tell you is a little bit more about these small RNAs that I was telling you about and how powerful and potent and wonderful they really are. And so you and me, I think, I haven't had my genome sequence, I don't know, but probably have only got one dice. Where's humans? They're mammals. We're pathetic. We've only got one dice. Whereas these guys here beat you for dead. They have got, these guys have probably got about six or eight different dice. But an Arabidopsis plant, and I should show you an Arabidopsis plant, because I thought, so that's this world-famous Arabidopsis plant, first plant to have its genome sequenced, five little chromosomes, and lots of people work on this plant around the world. Whereas this guy, so this is comes from Europe, whereas this guy is pure native Australian, comes from around Alice Springs in the way out in the remote area, and this is my favorite plant. We'll get onto it in a minute. Okay, so they have got Arabidopsis, that little plant over there, has got four different dices, not just the one. And, in fact, all plants have got four different dices of this thing. You may have more genes, like this guy, because he's got two genomes in him, but they still come into four different types, imaginatively called 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay? And what I would like to show you is that there are, whereas we have the equivalent to a dice of one, and so does every multicellular organism. And in fact, without this dice of one, we would just be blobs of slime. We would just be single cell organisms. This thing will actually cut, as I told you 2 days ago, about how to make a hairpin that would actually an RNA that would fold back and look like double-stranded RNA. And how that was, I thought we were really cool to design this, you know, this is against the antivirus, and we had come up with this brand new idea. Well, nature had come up with this idea 100 million years ago or something, so we were a little slow, and that it actually codes for its own little hairpins. But instead of, with a virus, we put in long double-stranded RNA, and the dicer cuts up into all sorts of little bits, you know, all the way along the double-stranded RNA. This dicer cuts one hairpin RNA that's made by the plant or by the human, and it just cuts out just 121 duplex from this hairpin. So very precise, a very precise sequence. And that is the key, the sort of like the barcode, if you like, to recognize one gene. So what this is actually doing is it's cutting out, when we have got something like 1,000 different ones of these. Plants, Arabidopsis, we've got about 300 so far. But we've got maybe 1,000 of these things, and they cut it out, and they're very specific for killing off a gene, and they often regulate development. So the very first one that was ever found in a nematode was because this poor little nematode is in a juvenile state, and if it doesn't produce that right, what we call a microRNA, to kill off this developmental gene, it will be stuck as a larval nematode forever. It's forever young, you might say. Maybe that's a good thing, but that's the thing. Without it, nothing happens. It will just be stuck there. And we now discovered that basically there's one pathway here, which is sort of virus defensey sort of stuff, and one pathway here, which is the one that's shared with animals and plants, which is all about development. And so here we have killed off these different genes. And so this is a wild type Arabidopsis plant, and here's a plant where we've knocked out dice of one. And as you can see, this is the same age, he's a very confused, sad little plant. Whereas if you knock out two or three or four, if you don't challenge him with the virus, then he's quite happy. And so, just to summarize that, in us, in animals, these little microRNAs are involved in differentiation, making the bloodstream, actually the generation of the blood, your blood system, and so everything virtually you could imagine is all regulated by these cancers. They all go up, and different ones go up, different ones go down. So major importance. Similar in plants. You might not worry so much about them, but they certainly care about it. Their flowers don't form, their leaves, their stress responses and so on. So these tiny little RNAs are actually essential for life. And what happened was that when plants and animals separated from these single cell type things, they had like the building blocks that you see in sort of bacteria that haven't been assembled in this process. But you've got single cell animal life, single cell plant life. And they both want to be multicellular, and they both want to talk to each other to say, well, actually, you are going to make a head, and you're going to make an arm, and you're going to make a leaf, and you're going to make a flower, and so on. So they need to talk to each other. And it's these little guys that are actually doing this talking. And I will hopefully show you, well, I will show you, unless you throw me out, that these things will actually move around in the plant, these small RNAs. They're not only you make them in a cell, but they can move from cell to cell. Okay. And so that's just, this is just a diagram showing these are sort of, we number these microRNAs in certain numbers and they regulate these different genes and they have these different effects. And so this is your wild type Arabidopsis that I showed you. If you mess with Dicer 1, you get a very sick plant. You mess with Argonaut 1, you get a sick plant. And you mess with DRB1, which is the guy that transfers the small RNA from the Dicer to the Argonaut, you get a sick plant. So this just show you that these guys really are pretty important. And in fact, this is a gel showing you the abundance of these, just two of these microRNAs. As I say, there are maybe 300 of these guys. And just knocking out this DRB1, he's sick, and yet he's making these small RNAs, but just not enough of them. So this is number 167, this is number 159. In this plant, you produce this level. In this plant, you produce this level. So it's, as I kept on saying, important beasts. And again, here's again an Argonaut. And if we really mess with this, and I'll tell you this later, we can even turn these things into seahorses or something. This used to look like that until we did stuff to it. Okay. So now, that was your microRNAs. That was your through of microRNAs and how important they are and how you should respect them and love them. Because without them, you're in trouble. And now I wanted to tell you really about these small RNAs and how they can move and how we can visualize these things and how we do this in this benthamiana plant. But what I also wanted to illustrate was just the power of technology that we now have, because this little guy has got five chromosomes, 250 megabases, 250,000 bases. Is that right? 250 million bases, that's right. 250 million bases in that genome. Whereas, and that was sequenced, and it took 10, 15 countries. It took them 20 years. It took about, 100, 200 million or some, a huge number. And they did this, and they've done this in about the early 2000s. Whereas Roger, me, Julia, and Ken, so four of us, in this last year have sequenced the genome of Nicosiana benthamiana at 3.1 gigabases. So that's, whatever it is, 3.1 thousand million bases because of the technology that we have now. Here's the genome, and this is the beast that does it. So the technology now that you can have your genome is about 3.2 gigabases. So that plant has got almost exactly the same size genome as you. Again, the human genome cost, God knows how much that costs to sequence. So technology is really changing. This little machine that you just get your DNA and you cut into little bits, you stick it on and you do sort of fancy sort of lasery stuff, labeling, whack it in this machine and you get masses and masses of sequence. Actually, only about 35 to 50 bases. So you've got to use... This is a really cool machine, and it tells you all this information, and you just loading it in, it goes down each of these tracks. Each track costs money. It does still cost you about $5,000 to $10,000 to run on each one of those tracks. But you get a massive amount of data. And then you pump it into a computer which has got something like, I mean, if you guys are computer, I'm sure you're more computer savvy than me, but it's got something like 10 terabytes of RAM in it. So this is a massive bloody computer. And you whack it in there, and then you go to the beach for about 10 days. And then you come back, and hopefully it's assembled it all up for you, because it's, you know, it's tiny, and yet it's massive that you're going to have to stick it together. So it's the power of this computer, this technology in this computer, that allowed us, just the four of us and that machine and a big computer in Auckland in New Zealand, to assemble this genome. And if you're particularly interested, if you go to benthgenome.com, there is our proud genome of this little beast here. And here we go. So this is a fabulous plant, and you're probably wondering why I'm drivelling on about this, but I'll show you why in a minute. First of all, it is great because it comes from the bungle bungles. It comes from out here, and so it's a great excuse to grow a beard and to go bush and go and try and find this, and thousands of kilometers from anywhere. And in actual fact, there's one strain that got sent around the world in the 1930s. And I don't know if you guys have seen Wolf Creek, have you seen Wolf Creek, that in the movie with all that nasty stuff? Well, there's a crater they go and visit before they get got by the killer, right? So this is where this guy actually comes from, just a few hundred kilometers away from Wolf Creek. So a brave plant. And to get to that Wolf Creek thing, in actual fact, these guys came from South America when Gondwana land was all stuck together. So here it was in what was to become South America. It had six chromosomes then, and it headed off the same sort of time as the opossum was heading off over here to become the kangaroo. It was heading off across Antarctica, which obviously wasn't that cold then. And in fact, so there's a nice story about this. There's a guy called Goodspeed, and he's like the guru. He's dead now, but he was the guru of all this tobacco and Nicotianery stuff. And he said that what happened was that you had two cousins that came across, they split apart, they jumped apart of their genomes, and then when they got across here before Australia was just sort of setting adrift 35 million years ago, you had these two cousins. One had 24 chromosomes and one had 16 chromosomes. And then by some really immoral, illegal, totally reprehensible sort of sex and duplicating of the chromosomes and so on, it managed to swap from 24 and 16 to get to 20 chromosomes. And that this was the key. This then allowed these plants to spread from here where they came in about Melbourne right across Australia, spreading out into 23 different species from this bizarre happening thing that happened there. Okay. So there's your history, and now why have I been going on and on about this benthamiana? So, because when we're doing most of our research, we're doing it in Arabidopsis, and we're putting our genes in there, and it takes us like 3 to 6 months to put a gene in here and to see what it's doing. But with this guy, all we do is we whack the bug, the DNA into bacteria, which takes us an hour or something. You grow it up overnight, and then you put it in a syringe with no needle or anything, and you just literally take this, not much skill required, and you just turn the leaf over and squirt it in into that sponge. It is that easy that you can. That's it. You have actually transformed that area with your genetic construct. So if I go to the next slide, actually, so this is that jellyfish protein that I was talking about earlier. So here we have, well, don't worry about the labels, that's just stuff we've done, but this is that jellyfish protein that's been just squirted in. 3 days later, you're getting this massive expression. So now I'd like to ask somebody if anybody wants to give this a go. So what we can do is because we like looking at RNA and we like looking at how an RNA can move, and in fact the perfect RNA designed to move from cell to cell is actually a plant virus. It's a virus. So here this is a virus. It looks just like a piece of, it looks like a sort of a cylinder, but it's actually like a helix all the way around. And what we can do is and inside that is the RNA. So we can actually whip it open, whack in a jellyfish gene, because we were putting it into Drosophila 2 days ago. We've now put it into this plant virus. And then we can go and we can put this into the plant, and we can see, instead of, in the old days, you used to have to kill the plant and make it radioactive and all kinds of stuff to see the virus. Whereas now, we just put it in the genome of the virus, put it in the plant, and you can just watch it move around. And so, I think we can turn the lights down again, if we may. But what we actually do is we slightly cheat, because we actually have the virus in that same bacterium that we were squirting in with the GFP, so that it will actually jump out of the bacteria and then move off as the real virus and spread. So we do that squirt of inoculation here. You can see the little mark where the syringe was, and then with time, it spreads out, and this is this moving front, and it's going to now come down the vein. So it's going whoosh, down the vein and spreads down the roots and up to the top. And so it's amazing that you can see this and see how fast it moves. And we can see it going in literally, what I'm going to show you, this movie in 2 days. And, yes, I quite like making movies, so I add soundtracks to this, so I'll see how this goes. So hopefully you saw from that, as well as appreciating Pete Townsend, Roger Daltrey, The Who, not CSI intro, this is the classic 70s English band, that that intro. So what you see is the virus comes up really fast and spreads through that in 3 days. And so the plant, if it's going to fight, what it's got to do is it's got to fight this virus at the same time. That virus is going flat out. And the plant really wants to, it can either sit there and wait for it to come, and it can just, once it's been infected by the virus, it can just let the other cells fend for themselves and just not say anything. Or it can be a good neighbor and it can actually send a signal to the other cells saying, hey, there's a bloody virus coming, get ready, load your dicers, load your argonauts, and get ready to kill it off. And so while that's the virus is doing that, the plant is responding. It's making those small RNAs, and it's sending them off at the same time, the same route. And I can hopefully show you that. Oops, before I do that, just a bit of boring theory. Here we are, just the different dicers. These are the small RNAs, and you can see that it's dicers 2, 3, and 4. If we knock them out, you can actually see, hopefully you can see that band is further down the gel, which is a 21, and that's made by dicer 4, and that band is 22, and that's made by dicer 2, and that band is 24, made by dicer 3. So you've got these three dicers, and very conveniently, they actually make slightly different sizes, so you can see what's going on. Nearly. I think we've got another movie in a minute. So what we've done is we've put in, I showed you the virus moving through the plant. So what I want to convince you is that there are little small RNAs trying to fight the virus off, that are trying to kill it off. And so what we can do is we can do a little trick here, because if we say, well, we've now put into the genome of this virus, we've put actually that gene for the GFP. So that's now part of the virus. So if the plant is seeing that as the virus and it wants to kill it off, it's not only going to be trying to kill off all this RNA, but it'll also be trying to kill off the RNA that's coding for the GFP, because it thinks that's a virus gene. That's the same thing. So dicers 2, 3, and 4 are going to be going at it, chopping this up, making small RNAs, against not only the virus, but also against the GFP within the virus. So what we then do is we take our normal non-transgenic benthamiana and we transform it. We put in into the genome, we put in a GFP gene so that it actually fluoresces. But we put it in as a mild expressor. So it's not like super bright green because we're going to put on the green virus on top. So we want it to be just sort of a nice orangey color like this. So that here we've got this transgenic plant. It's producing the GFP, and we're going to put in this virus, and it's going to also contain that GFP gene. So that when, with luck, the plant is going to fight off, try and kill this virus, it's going to be making these small RNAs that will not only be fighting the virus GFP here, but it'll also be fighting the messenger RNA for the GFP gene that we've put into the plant. I don't know if I've lost you all, but anyway, I'll show you the color in a minute, and then hopefully I'll tell you what the color means. And then the deal is, we then put in the virus. And so hopefully you can see these purple spots here, where these are where we've squirted in the virus, and you can see that the virus is spreading up and spreading through the plant, and here is the it's not orange anymore, it's purple. It's gone back to the color of the chloroplast. And that's because these small RNAs, the plant is fighting back and trying to kill them. Here's some zoom up. So this is the wild type, there's the virus, as it spreads out here, it's in that orangey color. And hopefully you see the virus is inoculated there, it's spreading out, now it's going down the veins. But behind it, this is now a darker purple, whereas this is a sort of an orangey color. So here, the plant is winning. It's beating the virus, but here, the virus is winning because the virus is ahead and is fluorescent. So that's no good, obviously. That doesn't help the plant very much because this is where the virus has been, not where the virus is going. And so it has this capacity to actually send these small RNAs, send this antivirus signal along at the same time as the virus. And so if you leave it long enough, your challenge with the virus here, these are the same plant, but this is having had that fluorescent virus put in it, and this one when it hasn't had the virus. So we put the virus down here. This leaf, as it's come up, this leaf, the virus is winning. The plant is beginning to fight it. This leaf, the virus is about half and half. But by the top of the plant, you can see that these small RNAs have been sent up the plant and are actually protecting that plant. And then, oh, this is the spot up. You can actually see it. It's coming in and see it. Here are the small RNAs are coming out without a virus, and here's the virus coming out without small RNAs. And so this is the battleground that's going on. And so we can actually mimic this without putting a virus in here. So we want to show you this again, because if we could get small RNAs to move, I mean, imagine if we could, I mean, maybe it's a bit, with our blood system, you might think, well, it's nothing to sort of put something in here and to spread around. But in actual fact, spreading through cells is really important. The bloodstream will sort of helps, but you really got to move cell to cell. And with a plant, if you have an orchard, say, full of an orange orchard, and it gets a virus, what would be great is to just go along and you just vaccinate it. You just squirt it in the leaf, and it will spread through the plant and protect it against the virus. So we're trying to see if you can do that without a virus. And I want to demonstrate it here. So what we've done is taken, this is Arabidopsis, and this is just wild type, and you shine the blue light on it, and you get this red color. But here we've put in a jellyfish gene, and it's now bright. So that's the construct. This is a promoter. That's the gene, and that's all you need. Promoter and the gene, which produces the messenger RNA. And we've also made some Arabidopsis plants, but they've got the promoter and the jellyfish gene, but we've also made that a hairpin construct, which produces that hairpin that folds back, which gets chopped up, which makes the small RNAs that kills off that GFP gene. So here it's trying to make fluorescent protein, here it's trying to kill it off. And so what we can now do is we can do some talk about nanotechnology, some micro grafting. Imagine doing the grafting on these tiny little seedlings. What we do is we take this tiny little growing tip from here, and we get this, and we chop the top off, and we graft this tiny little tip, which looks like this, if you magnify it up, and graft it on the top, so that you've got a little tiny little plant like that. A pinhead would be about this size. And so here you have GFP plaid on the top and a hairpin against the GFP at the bottom. And so if we can get these guys to move, what we really want to do is to say, can we get small RNAs to move from here, which we generated from the hairpin, move up into that top part of the plaid? So here's the graft after 3 days. It's not a very good graft, it's actually an angle, but you can actually see that the vasculature is severed. This is not joined to this, but after 7 days, and that's just showing you it's still severed, but after 7 days, it's reconnected. And so if there are some small RNAs, you can send it up the plant. So what we're trying to do is do this graft, send the smalls up from the bottom to the top. Okay, like that. And so, again, I'm going to show you a movie, and obviously, I guess, if it didn't work, I wouldn't be showing you this. So what we do, if this plant was to then grow just normally, without anything, it would just continue to fluoresce green. So what we're trying to do is we're saying, can we send some small RNAs up the top? And again, I think this one's got some Rolling Stones this time. We did that one, and we named it because this was actually the first time we'd ever done that, and it really did blow our minds to actually the ability to spread the silencing signal to get it mobile. And so hopefully what I can now, you can, from the graft, it looks like this, and you see that if you imagine that that's the green, if you imagine the green is the virus and the red is the silencing signal, which is protecting against the virus, which I've shown you in the graft. And then you go back to this guy in 1928 with his plant. Here is the virus, and here is the protected one. And so hopefully you can see the parallel, that what, without any interference, what's actually going on in certain virus-host combinations is that the plant is able to send up a signal and protect itself. Okay. But that's a sort of a cheat. Now, this is a movie that's still making, which, so it's just soundless, I'm afraid. But it... shows you much more what it's like in the, how a virus really moves. In that graph, it sort of came up and it was just solid red. So this is the signal. So the virus you saw came up in the vasculature. We now see, hopefully, the signal. We've squirted it here with a hairpin, which is silencing the GFP. And then, again, this one should just show you. So as it grows, what hopefully you can see two things, I hope. Here's the signal. It's coming up. First, it's going through the vasculature. You can see it up in the veins, but it's only gone up this part of the plant. So here's this growing point. So the signal is now coming up into here, and it's completely silencing. So that bit would be completely protected against the virus. Whereas here, it's just against the veins, and the virus could be replicated. But once this is triggered, you see all this new stuff growing here is completely red. So this part of the plant would be completely protected, whereas this guy's, the war is still going on. And so you have this balance going on between the plant and the virus fighting it. Okay, so I don't know how I'm going for time. 10 minutes, good, cool, perfect. So I guess the deal was be that if this was all it was, then you'd say, well, no plant would ever have a virus because you've got this beautiful defense mechanism. So I'm just going to illustrate this because it's one of my favorite viruses that shows you that how elegant nature can be. So here we have this beautiful virus, potato leaf roll virus. Plants don't grow beautiful. But it has just got 6,000 bases. That's all it's got. 6 genes crushed onto 1 piece of RNA. And in fact, when we were sequencing this, we sequenced a cousin first and identified these genes. And so we numbered them genes imaginatively, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And then we sequenced this guy as a cousin and found an extra gene upstream. So we actually, that's why it's called 0, because we'd already used numbered the other ones 1 to 6. So that, not computer savvy. That's just because we forgot that number. So, but P0, this very first protein is the most elegant protein, I think, because, as I say, when the virus is coming into the plant, it's coming in here, it's being diced up, and you've got these argonauts killing it. So how are you going to fight this mechanism? You've only got 6 genes. In fact, you can only put 1 gene. You can only make 1 protein that's going to defend you against this system that's evolved over millions of years. And what it does is the P0, it kills off this argonaut protein. And it does this, I think, in a very beautiful way. Is that in a cell, we have our proteins, you know, get old, they want to be turned over all the time. You actually have a garbage disposal thing. It's called a proteasome. It's a sort of a cylinder. And what happens is when a protein is getting old, or it's one that you want to be turned over quickly, there's a little system here which is a bit like an antibody system. It's this protein here called an F-box. And it recognizes this protein. It's like an antibody. It recognizes that specifically. And it brings in this complex of proteins. And what this does is it puts what's called a ubiquitin, which is just like a little tag. It just puts this tag on there. And that's just a label that says, take me to the garbage disposal, throw me down here, munch me up into my amino acids again, and then they can be recycled and we can make new proteins with it. So this is going on in the plant all the time for turning over proteins. You've got this recycling of your proteins. So the virus, being very smart, all it does is it produces this beautiful protein called P0, and it interacts with this plant protein, that protein, that protein, that protein, to bring it in, and its sticky end is to argonaut. And so it literally, just this one protein, recognizes the key player in the plant defense mechanism that's going to be killing it, the virus, off, and it turns this protein garbage disposal against the defense mechanism. So it's using the whole beautiful protein turnover system against its whole defense system and makes it completely inactive. And that's how the virus is able to completely to move through the plant and to survive and not be killed by the mechanism. Okay, so almost to wrap it up now. So technologies, we're trying to produce lots of biotech applications. There are lots of high-value proteins, often proteins that you would like for human therapies that you don't want to produce in animal cell culture because you can get all kinds of nasty things in there. And that they, if you can produce them in a plant, you can produce you can produce antibodies, tumor necrosis factors, all sorts of different things in a plant very cheaply. So how can you do this? And also with personalized medicine. So what it's seeming is that somebody's going to have some disease and you really want an antibody very specific to that individual or a particular protein, very specific. So how are you going to do that quickly? Well, I think the hope is that this guy is what you're going to do. You're going to actually make it in the lab specific for you, put it in the plant, and make it produce bucket loads of it for you. But what we can do, instead of, so this is just your normal virus spreading in here, and it could have been just a spot that we just squirted in of just the gene in itself. But if you use that P0 protein and squirt it in at the same time, and this is just the same, I'm going to show you exactly the same exposure, but now it's got that P0, so it's stopping that defense mechanism, then you're going to get this great big overexpression. So now we have a system where you can produce bucket loads of this protein really fast without any of the complications of animal cell culture. Okay. I think that's probably, I've got one more story. You can cope? Yeah, all right. Okay. I'll tell you this last one. I'll be quick. This one is about self versus non-self. So it's again with the small RNAs. And the idea is that I showed you all about the spreading of the silencing and the spreading against the green fluorescent protein and so on. And how you use the hairpin. And I also told you early on about how we can kill off genes, like you can kill off, that oil modification, certain enzymes to make you have a healthier oil and so on. So you can target with a hairpin, you can target, any gene you like, whether it's a gene you've put in, like a green fluorescent protein, or the endogenous gene. But the amazing thing is that, because I'll explain why I'm going to tell you this in a minute. The amazing thing is that you'd think you've got a gene and you put it in the plant, and it's inherited and it's expressed, and the plant would think it's just a normal gene. But somehow, the plant is able to tell the difference between the gene that you put in and the gene it inherited from its mum. So, and I'll illustrate this, because here we have the hairpin against this endogenous gene, and when we put it in, this disophore chops it up, and what we've done is we've made this hairpin sequence just against the front half of this gene, so what we might call a CH sequence. So it's going to be just targeted from here, say, to here, and it makes these small RNAs, and it will cut it up, and it'll give you those yellow seeds. It kills off the expression of this gene because it's munched the RNA at this end, but it's not targeted against this end, which you might call the S sequence, and so that sort of remains intact, but this bit has been chopped up. And you can do that with other genes. So here is we've killed off the photosynthetic mechanism, so it does the same thing, and here this is flowering time. And if we look at, I'll say that again. So these are the endogenous genes, but we can put in reporter genes or transgenes, and so that's the green fluorescent protein gene, and in fact this is a blue gene which we used to use before we could use the green fluorescent protein. So these are reporter genes. These are genes that we've put in, and these are genes that nature has put in. And then so you might say that these are self genes and these are non-self genes. So I showed you fabulous Illumina HiSeq 2000 machine that can actually sequence massive amounts of sequence. We can not only do that for the genome, but it can also sequence these tiny little RNAs. And so we make these plants, and we extract them, and we sequence these tiny little small RNAs, and then we map them back. And so in this one, we killed off this photosynthetic gene, and we made a hairpin just against this sequence. And these are mapping back and to this region, saying the only small RNAs against this gene have been made here, which is against the double-stranded RNA that we put in, which was only that sequence. And same with the Charcot synthase. We put in a hairpin across this region, and these spots are just saying it's here. There are no small RNAs further downstream or upstream of the gene. So that's the endogenous gene. So it's really tight. But if we do our transgene, and this is our GFP, our August gene, our blue gene, and we targeted it just between this region here, and you can see the small RNAs are actually spreading upstream and downstream on that gene. So you target it here, but somehow they've been amplified and you've got them spreading out. So, which is, if you might think about it, it's like an immune system. You know, when you first get your virus in, you make your first IgMs, which are just rough ones. They're just roughly recognizing your infection. But then you produce IgG, which is this really refined and amplified killers against what you've put in. And this plant is doing somehow the same thing with your transgene. It's triggering it off here, but it's actually spreading out and got the ability to kill it all off. So here it's saying this is an endogenous gene and this is fine and I treat it that with respect and don't mess with it. I don't spread and kill it and refine my killing system. Whereas here it's thinking it's a virus and it's spreading out and becoming a stronger response to kill that off. So that's really quite bizarre in a way. And so what I'm showing you this for is I wanted to show you just again the power of the new technology of deep sequencing and mutagenesis. Because we can sequence whole genomes in a day, basically, we can now use the power of mutagenesis, which used to be a really old-fashioned technology. You know, you'd get your plant, you'd zap it with a mutagen, and you'd find the mutant of what you want, and then you'd spend the next 10, 15 years trying to work out what gene you had zapped that gave you the phenotype that you want. But because we can now sequence entire genomes, we can rapidly map the mutation. And so what we've done here is we've taken this, we said, we really want to see what's going on with this spreading. How is it that a transgene gets this spreading and an endogenous gene doesn't get the spreading? And so if I say here, so this is, if we've done this grafting and we put in a hairpin against the front end and it moves up to the top because this is a nice way of, you can separate it out. So this is against the hairpin at the bottom, small RNAs moving up, but they're moving against the foot, say the GF is where we've targeted them. But if we look at the silencing at the top, we find all the small RNAs, and most of them, have spread down to the back end of that gene. Whereas if we do this with an endogenous gene, that chalcone synthase, and we do the same grafting, it stays only in the bit that we targeted. It doesn't spread down. So what we can do is we can use a mutagenesis approach. And what we've done is we say, well, okay, if you target the front end of this gene, which is the endogenous gene, it doesn't have this thing called transitivity. It doesn't spread. But what we want to do is we want to somehow kill off the protein that is, or presuming the protein, that is protecting this thing that says this is an endogene, not a transgene. So that if we can do that, if we can get a mutation, what we're looking for is a mutation where the small RNAs come up here, they're killing it off here, but it actually will spread down here into this region. And what we've done is we've stuck this same sequence that was the back end of here on the back end of the GFP, so that if we are able to get a mutation that allows this spread to happen, it will then actually, these small RNAs will kill off that GFP. It's probably a bit complicated, but basically we set up a construct that if we can find the mutation that is in the mechanism that is protecting endogenous or self genes and allowing the death of invading transgenes, we should get the plants going from green to red. And so I wouldn't show you this if it didn't actually work. So here we have these orangey plants, and hopefully you can see just this one mutant here. This one plant. So we've taken these plants, we've set up that system, they all look like this, we zap them with a mutagen, there are mutations happening everywhere, and we're looking for the one in a 5,000 event. But because we've set it up for this color, you can say, you can screen this 5,000 in a morning just by holding that light and going around and going, ha, here's the mutation. And so, this is perhaps the cool bit of computing again. So that if we've now got our mutant that is now a red plant. And so we've got somewhere, but we've made mutations everywhere. And somehow it's homozygous mutant is giving us that phenotype, that red phenotype, while the wild type or mutations in other genes are giving you the orange. And so all you do is you take your mutant plant and you cross it with the wild type, so that they're all going to be hemizygous, so it's going to have the mutation on one of the chromosomes, but not on its pair, and so it'll still have that fluorescence. But then you allow it to self, so then everything is all recombining, and all these sort of these sequences, all these chromosomes are just exchanging stuff. So you're going to get a huge population of all this recombination. But in your mutation, the one that's going to give you your red leaf, you go and you select that plant and that plant and that plant and that plant. And the only same thing that you're selecting for is for it to be homozygous for this at this point. The rest can be recombined. And so you just take these plants, you deep sequence the genomes of 50 or 100 of these, and you say, okay, where is the one region that has actually got the sequence that came from the parent rather than a cousin with that, we've got these polymorphisms that allow us to separate us. I should have explained that. But you can basically say, where is it the one region that is coming from here, which is preserved? Because in all these individuals, that you have a chance, a 50-50 chance, that it came from the blue parent or the orange parent. But what you're looking for is perfect blue. And so by doing that, you can actually do the map, and you go, yes, 50% all the way around, blah, blah, blah. But just there, one point where it's 100%, in this case it's 100% red, not 70% red, 25% blue or whatever, it's 100% red. And that tells you that point there, that one base change that you've sequenced 250 megabases, That is the one base change that has given you your mutation. And so this gives us tremendous power these days to find out new things. We go using this old-fashioned technology. You say, I want to see something. I want to see how it works. I have no idea how it works. And you just mutagenize it until it gives you the phenotype you want. And then you just deep sequence the lot and say, what did you change? And so just to illustrate that, what's actually protecting it is this complex here, which we had no idea. If you said now, make a prediction of what it is that's protecting self genes from non-self genes, you would have said it's chromosome modifiers or all sorts of things. You would never really have predicted that it was actually a transcription termination complex. And yet, when we looked, we got six different mutants and we did this mapping and we found one mutant was in that protein, the next mutant was in that protein, the next one was in that one, the next one was that one, and that. So that you know that every mutation that is stopping that system is coming from this complex of proteins that does that process. And so we've actually gone from having no idea how this thing works to identifying the complex. And it is, in fact, the polyadenylation and termination transcription complex. And that is what actually protects your self genes from your non-self genes. And at that point, probably you're completely bamboozled, but all I'd say is it's really cool stuff and it allows us to do great things. I should just thank, these are the guys in the lab, and here they are. Thank you. We're finished. We'll be right back.